and this is why I love fitness and health, because it doesn't live in the gym. What we do and what we take on mentally in a workout that scares us translates in our lives. It translates in our courage out there.
This is episode number 48 with Biggest Loser trainer, Jen Widerstrom. Welcome to Pursuing Health. I'm Julie Fouché, medical student and former CrossFit Games athlete. Here, I bring to you information and inspiration from experts and everyday individuals for how to use lifestyle to maximize health. Thank you so much for joining me. Now let's get started with this week's episode. Welcome to Pursuing Health. This is a really fun and powerful episode I recorded with Jen Widerstrom at her home CrossFit affiliate in Studio City, California, called CrossFit Horsepower. We caught up there for a workout while I was in town, and although this was only the second time I've been around Jen in person, she's incredibly down-to-earth, genuine, and easy to get to know, as I'm sure you'll hear in this episode. A little bit of background about her. She grew up outside of Chicago and competed in gymnastics growing up. She then transitioned into track and field, where she competed in throws for the University of Kansas. After that, she transitioned to fitness modeling and finally became a personal trainer. She appeared on American Gladiators in 2008 and has been a trainer on NBC's The Biggest Loser since 2015. She's also been doing CrossFit since 2012 and has made appearances on the CrossFit Horsepower Regional team in 2013 and 14. In this episode, we talk about Jen's own athletic background and some of her struggles with yo-yo dieting and exercising prior to finding CrossFit, as well as how CrossFit helped to change her perspective and her experience as a trainer on The Biggest Loser. Before we get started, I have a few quick reminders. First, if you're enjoying the podcast, please head over to iTunes to subscribe and consider giving it a 5-star rating. You can also head to my website, juliefouché.com, where you can enter your email to stay in the loop with the podcast and everything else I'm doing with my biweekly newsletter. I'm also always looking for inspiring stories to share. So if you or someone you know has used lifestyle to overcome a serious health challenge, please send your story to me at info@juliefouché.com and I'll select some to share here on future episodes. If you're interested in training with me, check out my program through Beyond the Whiteboard. This is the actual training that I do now, 5 days per week, 1 hour per day, scheduled out for you minute by minute from warm up to cool down. We also have a train on the go program that's perfect for helping you get your workouts in on vacation or during a busy week at home. There's still a couple days left on our free trial that ends February 12th, so don't miss the opportunity to check it out. For more info, visit beyondthewhiteboard.com/Julie Fouché. Finally, please remember that although I'm nearing graduation from medical school, this podcast is meant to share the experiences of individuals and does not provide medical advice. So with that, let's get started here with episode number 48 of Pursuing Health featuring Jen Widerstrom. Well, welcome to my podcast, Pursuing Health. I'm so excited to be here with Jen Widerstrom.
That is Widerstrom.
Widerstrom. Widerstrom. Honestly, but it's not W-I-E or just W-I?
W-I-D.
I-D. Okay.
It's Swedish, so it's like Widerstrom.
Okay. Because I'm used to German, which is like, normally it would be like W-I-E.
Which I am German.
Oh, interesting.
But it's a Swedish last name.
Okay. Well, yeah. Welcome to Pursuing Health. We're here with Jen Widerstrom.
This interview's over.
And I'm so excited that we finally made this happen.
Me too.
And you have so many exciting things going on, so I want to talk about those. But I know that you are a Midwest girl and grew up in Chicago.
Yep.
So I thought maybe we could start talking about that because I'm from Michigan. It's not Chicago, but it is the Midwest. So
it's no wonder we got along. Like literally, okay, I have to, before we even go there, it was so fun because obviously I've known who you are from afar. I've dabbled in CrossFit, you know, before we made it the Super Region, I got to compete on a team a couple times here at Horsepower. And I felt really special about myself. And so to be at the Mind Body Green Summit, and have Julie come into like the hotel gym and I just done what I thought was a pretty rocking workout. You came right up to me. You're like, hi. And I was like, hi. And I thought, oh God, she thinks I'm someone else.
There's no, because I think I knew you were coming because I had seen you on the, list,
the list
of people.
Okay, okay.
And so I was going to do a workout at the hotel gym and I'm like, oh, I don't really want to work out. What am I going to do? And I see all you guys in there doing CrossFit stuff and I'm like, yes, my people.
But I was so sure you didn't know who I was. I was like, and it happens to me a lot. People think, I've had paparazzi take pictures of me and be like, hey, Anna. Or I'm like, hey, like I don't want to ruin their day.
Yeah.
So I assumed you had no idea who I was. You thought I was someone else. And I was finishing up with Andrew Connor and Steve over at Reebok. So anyway, you come right up. You're like, hi. And I was like, hi. And then And you asked if we were still working out. And of course we just finished.
Yep.
And then we kept going.
And then I just dragged you in to do something else.
But you're like, okay.
Just do something else with me, please.
She's pretty menacing. I'm telling you. You think this is all an act. So then we do a whole nother workout, which was great. And then that was that.
Super fun.
So that's what was kind of cool. And you talked about your podcast and pursuing health. And it's funny because it's not just on this podcast. It's not just in the conversations you're having. It's literally in life. You're pursuing it, and you pursued it with us, and you had the conversation, and I did more, and I worked harder because you were there. You helped me pursue it for myself. It was just neat, accidental, awesome. Anyway, so back to Chicago in the Midwest.
It's
funny. So my folks, I should say, because people that are listening and watching are going to say, oh, you really from Chicago? Answer's no. My parents were city kids.
Okay.
And then when they decided to hook up and marry and make babies, they moved us out to the suburbs like Naperville, Lyle, Word Up team, Lyle, Naperville. And then was there my whole life and then went to KU for school.
Okay.
And then when I moved back to Chicago, I ended up going to Lincoln Park.
Okay.
So I had some living time there.
You were living in the city for some time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you were always very active growing up. What were you doing, playing sports? Or?
So it's, you know, my parents are both coaches. And so my mom was a gymnastics, volleyball, coach, PE teacher. And my dad did wrestling and football. And so for us, they wanted us to move. Like my brother, by the way, is like 6'5", which I don't know what happened to the height. Because my sister's 5'5", I'm 5'6". My brother's like, which is totally
missed
not fair.
Gene, yeah. And you have two siblings then?
Two siblings. Okay. So Kristen's the oldest and Eric's the youngest. But Eric is probably 6'5" and 280. But even though he turned out that way, when we were 3, 4, 5, my parents started us all in gymnastics.
Okay.
You know, it's the walking and the beam. It's carrying your carpet square.
Right.
And you do your butt drops.
Playing the games.
Right.
Yeah.
Because it creates this sense of body coordination and movement in space and a little bit of a strength and balance and all that stuff.
Yeah.
And so it was the one for me, like my sister's got tattoos and played music and I was like Jenny the gymnast, you know? So anyway, I did gymnastics for my entire life, starting lifting weights a little with my dad in the basement. Like we did like 5 pound weights,
And but like barbells or like dumbbells?
Dumbbell weights because I was only 8 or 9.
Oh, this is really young.
Oh,
young.
But my dad still claims that my best event was gymnastics, was bars because he's like, it's the weight training. I'm like, okay, Norm.
No, it's so true. Once I started doing CrossFit, I went back to try to do my gymnastics stuff and the bars were so much easier.
Right, because you have,
stronger.
It still becomes one of my greatest assets. And even though I don't have to work as hard as most women do because it was ingrained when I was young on the position. And even the lifting with my dad and now doing CrossFit, I kind of joke. I'm like, God, thank God that 10 years of gymnastics finally is paying off somewhere.
Right?
Cool. So I did that for a long time. And then high school started doing team gymnastics there, but then did diving and then some track. But I was one of those athletes that was never great at anything. I just was kind of good at a lot of things.
Yep.
So
I feel you on that.
I played the middle, which was
same
fun,
here.
You know?
Same here. I didn't get into the diving, but that was kind of a common trend for the gymnasts going to diving and then track and field and pole vaulting in the spring. And I did that. I did the track and field. But
what events did you do?
I did sprints, like 100, 200, and then I did pole vaults.
Oh, of course,
It's funny because then once I was in CrossFit, I was a much better endurance athlete, but I was never like that growing up. I was always more of a power athlete.
How long? Okay, now I got questions.
Yeah.
Because out of high school, then I went to track.
Right.
Oh, sorry. When I went to college, I actually walked on the rowing team.
I thought
this would be great. Yeah. I'm done with gymnastics. I'm going to try a different sport, which, by the way, I don't regret because rowing, I still have some of my best friends to this day
that
I met from
rowing.
I was the worst on the team. I would work so hard. I was like lifting like barbells. I was like really natural and strong. And I had the worst times. And I would improve like on the erg scores, like your 2K times, the big, benchmark. I would improve by like 20, 30 seconds and still have the worst time on the team. Like I would, any opportunity to stop and break, I didn't have the endurance.
Yeah.
And so then I ended up, the throws coach and the rowing coach were really good friends.
Okay.
And so Doug, my throws coach, was watching me, like we all shared the same weight room at this point.
Okay.
Watching me train and lift. And so he goes to the rowing coach and says, wow, she's like a great athlete, huh? She's only a freshman or sophomore, whatever. I was new. And Coach Catloth was like, oh, God, no. She's
slow.
She's actually pretty she struggles, you know? And he was like very nice about it. And Doug said, well, can I take her? Can I turn her into a hammer thrower?
Yeah.
And Rob's like, yeah, that's up to her. But like, you know, I was like, there's the A boat, there's the B boat, then there's like a four boat, and then there's a boat after that. I was like in one of those ones, like where we were so close, it was like the coach couldn't even, like the coach had to stay in their boat with like the fast boats.
Yeah.
So I just didn't have that endurance quality, which is why I'm so curious to find out how you turned it over, because up to that point, I was at max. Mm-hmm. You know, what's a floor routine? 60,
like a minute and a half,
75 minutes? Yeah. Okay. 75
minutes. Oh, gosh.
Oh, God. 75 minute floor routine. Could you imagine? But a 75 second floor routine, and even that gassed me.
Oh, yeah.
So I started throwing, and that was great. I'm like, oh, my God, I get to lift heavy. I remember I was snatching almost 200 pounds.
That's insane.
Like, whoop. So I was squatting. My squat max was 315.
Oh, my word.
I look back at my scores. I called coach. I was like, bud, check the scores.
Is this real?
Check the score. Because I have my logs. I'm a Virgo, and I hoard things. So I have every – I was doing sets of 275 for four.
Oh, my
three
word.
And four. And I thought – I remember passing out in the gym because, like, on front rack, like on front squats, it's like against your artery. You're like, you know what I mean? So anyway, it was so much fun. But again, it worked this system of velocity, power, you know, coordination, fast, speed, and hammer, but just power and application into that speed force. So, you know, obviously, you're smarter than me. Radius times speed equals distance. That's a hammer throw.
Okay.
Radius. Then we divide. There's an equation. Somebody needs to write us. Okay.
But we're blanking on our high school physics right now.
But, you know, it worked for me. So that's where, like, sports came in. And then it was funny. That's why I was so interested. Going into CrossFit, I remember my first day here.
When did you start CrossFit?
So I was at, you know, a clothing store. Mm-hmm. And the owner of our gym, Dan Wells, had come in. Oh, that's what it was. So I had worked at Lululemon for like 5 seconds, okay? Uh-huh. And Dan, because I chose to be an employee, I could no longer be the ambassador for this new store here in Studio City. So we needed to find another ambassador, and Dan Wells, okay?
Oh.
So I've been hearing about CrossFit, and this loser with a mohawk and crossfit everything. I was like, okay, hi pal, what's up? And he wanted to teach a CrossFit class in our store.
Okay.
And I thought, you are not teaching. What, you bring kettlebells in here? And I was really against it.
Yeah.
And by the end of the conversation, I really respected, because I had not learned about CrossFit,
the functional training,
the way that it was set up, the community aspect, his passion for it. And I was like, okay, you can teach a class here for sure. And then he's like, so are you going to take the class? Because, like, what are you doing? I was like, well, and at that point, my favorite term is FDO. Do you know this?
No.
For display only.
Oh, okay.
So
I haven't heard that one.
I looked fit, but nowhere near my level of ability in any of my sports or in conditioning and strength, nothing. And he goes, I can see it in you. What you do gymnastics, what you did Ollie lifting.
You have that fire in you.
Please come. And I'm thinking, at this point, I was like, just turning 30. Mm-hmm. He was out of his mind. I mean, for me, I've stood on my, I mean, I was a walk-on. I ended up earning a scholarship. I love being at the Big 12. Like, I'm like hanging him up. I don't need to try anymore.
Right.
And yet I found that I really missed that sense of community and working with people, that sense of
working towards something.
Yeah. You know, and this is why I love fitness and health, because it doesn't live in the gym.
Right.
What we do or what we take on mentally in a workout that scares us translates in our lives. It translates in our courage out there. And so I reluctantly, I mean, it probably took me a few weeks to go, came in here, and it was great because it was 5 rounds. Mm-hmm. I'll never forget. 5 rounds, 10 power cleans at 95 pounds.
Okay.
Joke. I was like, fine. Yeah. I mean, I was power clean 200 in college. I was like, I can
do that.
I'm fine. Half the weight. It's my warm up. Mm-hmm. And then 10 burpees. So 10 and 10,
okay.
5 rounds.
Wow. Gasser.
So, your reaction is like that. I go, oh, easy. I get through the 10 pretty well. And the burpees, I was like, oh,
what is
I'd
this?
I'd never done a burpee in my life, ever at 30 years old. So then I was like, okay, well, that was kind of rough. And I got back to the bar, and I was like, I'm like, you know? I never had to do ten burpees and then have to move a heavy barbell. Yeah. Or they worry about my grip, or I never learned hook grip ever.
Wow.
And I barely get through that, by the way, round two, five. And then I do a burpee. I get up. Okay, I go down. I put my head to the side.
We've all done it. I did it last week on the sevens.
And I laid.
Yeah.
And the girl that's like, oh, it's Jen's first time. She's like, you gotta
get up.
And I'm like, and I was just blown away. And I didn't. And I'll tell you what, scared me so bad. I didn't realize how much mental it would take, how much my strength is being good at the one thing that far right or whatever, far one-sided of just being strong, and how undeveloped I was as a full athlete. So it blew my mind. And then I remember there was like for 6 months, and I mean, I've admitted to people I like that love me, but never publicly, but I remember if there was running or burpees on the workout, like you walk and you see the board, I bought a protein bar and I left.
You were out.
I was like ready to go, and I was like, no, actually, I've got something. I'm just, oh, wait, this is good. I have no idea. I charge my account. I'm out of here. Because it made me so nervous. So it's interesting.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Did you finish that first workout or did you stop after a second round?
I wouldn't have quit.
No.
I think it took me longer than I should have, and my ego was hurting for a while.
Yeah.
Because this other girl, by the way, as athletes, you kind of look around the room, you think.
Right. I can do this.
I can do that. And this cute skinny girl, Laura. She did her workout. She went first. And I was like, oh, how long did it take? I did not beat her.
No.
And that's what was so neat. You have to respect the room, your teammates, like where you're at. But, okay, so back to my question. How did you get over it? It took me time.
It's actually funny because it's something I realized after the fact. I think it was just my larger volume of training when I was training for competition, and I would have really high volume of training. And the first time I really realized it was in 2012. There was an event that was basically just a sprint down and back on the football field. And I got definitely the bottom five. Like I made it, I wasn't last place, but I was like pretty darn close. And I was like, I used to run, I used to sprint. I was pretty good in high school. I wasn't the best, but I was like the second fastest girl on the team.
Yeah.
Like, why am I doing so bad in the sprinting event? And then I would do really well in these longer endurance events. And it was just very eye-opening. But I was talking to someone, I was actually talking to Chris Hinshaw about it last weekend, and thinking about how my training was structured, and it was a lot of high volume. And I definitely did shorter workouts and more power. You know, we went for one rep maxes. We did that kind of stuff. But I think doing the higher volume, it just helped me kind of transition. And maybe that
like
is
mentally?
What my, no, I think physically, like I think that actually my like body and my fast, slow twitch muscle fibers were probably actually more towards an endurance athlete, but maybe in high school, I just, the thought of running long wasn't very exciting to me. And so I just never even tried it.
That's an interesting thing to think about. I mean, so then what would scare you more, a chipper or a short one?
I like both of those things.
Yeah. Okay. So what does scare you? Or does anything scare you anymore?
I don't know. I mean, I think even now, still the longer ones, I think scare me more because I think mentally for me, a longer event is just more daunting. Like,
so what's the fear and how do you get over it? Cause like, this is something that I really want to know, which I'm like, I know people want to know. Is it the, can I last? Will my tank run out?
Yeah.
What does it become?
Yeah, I think so. And it's just the long period of suffering, I think.
Remember that event? It was the 50s chipper for you girls 2 years ago.
Yep.
And Becca Voigt won the region here in SoCal. And all the girls come off the rower before her. Mm-hmm. All the girls finish the box jumps. Like, everyone's at like a station or two ahead of Becca. And she did not change her pace. Yep. And she just went, got the wall balls down, got the it was like the dips. And then boom, boom. And she hit a time that I don't think any other region beat.
Well, So actually.
Oh, did somebody beat it? Did you beat her?
I think I had the record for that workout. But
this is so
but
perfect.
It was the same story.
Oh, this is perfect.
So they
okay.
like basically all my times, because like then they went back and analyzed like what were my splits on each of the events, and they were all dead even, like on the way down and on the way back.
Oh.
And I don't, it's not something that I'm consciously thinking about, but I think that like.
Oh, like you're
I
saying
was just good
your row
at
time
pacing.
Was replicated.
Yeah.
Your like, box time was replicated
yeah,
down and back.
Yeah. Or if not, I was even a little bit faster coming back. Like I just have always naturally, I think, been good at pacing myself in longer workouts. I don't know.
Okay. So then, okay. Personal question. So I, or not personal, like.
We can get personal.
Yeah,
that's fine.
We will. So where I struggle is knowing that I'm actually pretty resilient when the bar gets heavy for people.
Mm-hmm.
I still can move it pretty well.
Mm-hmm.
But so here's my, for instance, a few days ago, it was like from CrossFit New England, and it was three rounds, mm-hmm. 30 hand cleans at 85, 115.
Okay.
30 unbroken wall balls.
Ooh, yeah.
30 calorie row, three rounds. And I was reading and I go, you know, barbell work is a party for me. Wall balls, ugh. And now I got to keep, I'm broken. That's mm-hmm. a little bit of a trigger.
Yep.
Rowing, I'm not in love with. I don't like run to the rower.
Right.
But I can
you
deal
can suffer
with
through it.
It.
Yeah.
I can deal with it. But I also get heady. In the wrong day, in the 1,000-meter sprint, mm-hmm. like 4 minutes in, I'm like, I'm only halfway. And
right.
I'll literally put the handle down. I'll have a conversation with myself. So
yep.
it's a give or take,
yep.
you know, the day. So I look at the workout. I'm like, this isn't too terrible. I think it should be okay. What's this, like a 10-minute workout? And then I got to the gym and saw people finishing the mm-hmm. workout, which never do that. Never, never, ever. And people are like, whoa. And the best girl that at that point had done it like 18 minutes and mm-hmm. change. And I go, this is almost double what I thought it
yeah.
would take. And so now I'm getting a little bit worried. And then I was thinking about doing the protein bar leaving thing.
Right.
It doesn't disappear. You know, no matter how far I come in my fitness.
Everyone
you know,
has that.
We have our little thing. And I go, no. Like, for me, my confidence builds when I do it through completion.
Mm-hmm.
With the open coming,
yep.
I want to put myself in scenarios that make me feel uncomfortable. And when I succeed through them,
mm-hmm.
I walk into any open workout and said, remember that time you were nervous and it had pull-ups and now you've got pull-ups again? You're going to be okay. Because
yep.
I've already proven
yep.
that I can. So that's why, for me, I need to make sure I keep moving. But anyways, I go through this workout. Like pretty fast. Like, I mean, I think my time was like 16 minutes.
Oh, nice.
Okay, 16
yeah.
and change. The only two people that beat me in the gym were a couple like taller gentlemen, mm-hmm. which this is that their kind of workout,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, totally.
And then what bothered me is I thought, never really got ugly.
Like maybe you should have pushed yourself harder.
Yes. So how
it's
do you
a
know?
Constant
so that's
struggle,
like,
yes.
This isn't like a pat. I was
right.
thinking, man, I mean, I pushed more at the end of the mm-hmm. row. I took my second set of unbroken wall balls,
mm-hmm.
I took 15 seconds. I'm like, totally set. We go.
Yep.
And then after my third round, I was getting a little bit nervous
yep.
here. I took 25 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
And it never got ugly. So
yeah.
how do we know when?
Yeah. Well,
like,
I think,
how do you gauge that? I
think it's part of the learning process. So, like,
yeah.
I think it's good to sometimes leave the gym and feel like, you know what? I probably could have given a little bit more, because then you know next time.
So it's a remember.
Yeah.
All
I don't
right.
think, like, I think it's like you're constantly dancing with that line. Like, you know, if you're killing yourself every day and like you don't want to push yourself to the point where your form is breaking down and you're going to injure yourself. But at the same time, you need to have intensity to get the results. So
yeah.
I think it's a constant.
Do you
you're
think
constantly dancing on that line.
Do you
and
think you've just
something.
Done enough WODs where that's where you know the feedback and that's how you know your body so well?
I think it helps. I think, like
yeah.
you said, the more experience you have, the more workouts you do, you learn something from every workout and then you get better at it. But I still, like, even now, I think you have to have those things that hold you accountable. So, like, when I was training specifically for competition, every day I was pushing myself harder because I knew that was my end goal.
Mm.
Now it's like, if I don't push myself right to that red line every day, no one's going to know.
Yeah.
You know, so it's harder because I think I require some more external motivation. It helps
100%.
Me when I work out with other people who push me because it's just that natural. It's what you get in any gym. Like having someone around you pushing themselves is going to help you do the same.
That's a really
so
good
I just
part.
Try to I put mean, myself in that environment.
I wouldn't have done half the ugly workouts we did without the team behind me.
Oh, yeah.
I mean,
totally.
No way. Like knowing when we would make regionals and I would program for us, they're not, it gets ugly.
Yeah.
And for me, I mentally feel I persevere and my passion goes up, my accountability goes up,
because mm-hmm.
I'm like, if I don't put in, I'm not just I'm not just training as a civilian. There's a team of people that are working here day in, day out that count on my performance.
Yeah.
And it's what I, it's what gets me over the edge to push. But like, and then that's why actually going in like this year, we're looking to do an open, do really well at the open. We've got a lot of great girls, a lot of great guys. And I'm one of those people that I can fill some gaps given the right work, right combinations.
Right.
And plus, there's that fear of one of our people go individual,
right?
Which is, by the way, the most amazing thing. Yeah. Like, as we want, I mean, how exciting to make individual in the SoCal regional. But if she goes, she takes her scores with her, and for me not to be prepared to fill those gaps,
step up. Yeah, totally.
Right, because I think in the past that wasn't the case, right? The scores would stay, and the person could go
individual.
You could
switch people out.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's true. That happened to us once. Mm-hmm. So true. But anyway, speaking of that, and speaking of accountability, I want to go back to after college.
Oh my God.
You're into, like, how do you make that? We talked about how you got into CrossFit, but what happened in between there? How did you end up deciding that you wanted to actually help people get healthy and go into training?
It's such a funny thing. So my degree's in sports administration.
Okay.
I thought, I'm going to like work with the sports team or work in their marketing stuff.
Okay.
Or even I thought about working back at KU and, you know, and working with, at my alma mater. There's a great position called the senior women's administrator, which is what you oversee a lot of the female sports, and you help a lot of the college athletes transition from college life and success there to life after. A lot of times I think there's a loss of identity.
Absolutely.
Because I remember, I hit the wall of up to the day I graduated. You're like, Jen, what's going on?
Yeah.
I go, oh, so much. I'm actually a D1 athlete at the University of Kansas. Yeah, I've earned a scholarship in hammer throw. Placed at the conference meet. It was really fun. Went to nationals. Oh, academically, I'm working on a degree in sports administration. Yeah. And I've got and all these titles and identity is there.
Yep.
And because I did that, I never actually had to work on who I really was. And then, oops, I graduate. And, hey, Jen, what's up? Like today?
Yeah.
Oh, and I would have to search. And I mean, at that point, I was interviewing for my degree, not getting hired. So I'm bartending in my hometown. No shame in that, by the way. It saved me. It kept I paid my bills.
Yeah.
So I was bartending and waiting tables and then not getting hired and bartending and waiting tables and not getting hired for the other job. And I thought, oh, God, well, now what do I do?
Yeah.
And then I was seriously considering going back to KU. And then I'd done fitness modeling, like one photo shoot.
Okay.
Again, still no connection to health and fitness. Training for performance, which is what I'd done my whole life, is very different than health and fitness and pursuing health, pun intended, right? So I just was executing for action, executing to win my medal and to keep my scholarship. So now here I am, by the way, eating the same way I did in college, which if I would commonly have a Chipotle burrito, finish up and be like, I think I'm gonna get another one. I'm gonna hop back in line. Anybody extra guac?
Yeah.
Okay. And have no problem doing that and didn't see anything wrong.
Yep.
But my training was at such a level, it's gotta be similar from when you were training for the games and stuff. You just go through the calories so it doesn't show up anywhere and you kinda go through the fuel so it doesn't really bog you down.
Right.
So now here I am, you know, eating the same way, trying to fitness model, and now I'm crash dieting for photo shoots.
Okay.
And then binging the night after to be like, whoa, Oreo cookies and pizza and whatever. And then I have a shoot again and crash. So I was kind of yo-yoing again, training, eating for performance. Now this time for the outside, totally FDO.
Yeah.
I'm not squatting. I'm not moving. I think I'm doing the Stairmaster. This is a time in my life where portable DVD players are really cool.
Oh, yeah.
So I would have my little leg. Like my little whoop, like on my Stairmaster.
Up on the Stairmaster,
and I was watching CSI episodes.
Just all day.
And when the episode concluded, I knew I could get off the Stairmaster.
Okay.
I mean, and everything I know of health and fitness, I'm like, wait, you just climbed the stairs for 42 minutes? That's all you did? You didn't stretch. You didn't do any kind of core. You didn't do any kind of strength training. You went out and it was half off wine night somewhere. So I'm drinking a bottle of wine, not fueling afterwards. I mean, I had no idea. And so in the mix of all that, American Gladiators, the casting directors, saw my pictures in the magazines, which the pictures are hilarious, I'll send you. And they thought, hey, I get an email, will you come audition for Gladiators?
Yeah.
I thought it was a joke. I have really funny friends. I've been a gladiator for Halloween multiple times. I was like, I remember I sent them, I'm like, I got the outfit. I got it. So sure enough, it's not fake. I go, I audition, they pick me, I become Phoenix. I've got pink hair. a tiny uniform, and I basically get to wrestle around with like Gina Carano and like all these like fitness and like greats in all these health fields. So seasons of that go, maybe short run, one or two seasons, gets canceled. Now what? And this was at the precipice of where, what am I going to do here? Can I go back to bartending? Because that doesn't really fulfill me anymore. I've had this step towards TV. Where do I live? And now once again, I had made my identity about the show, about what I looked like, about being on TV, and therefore, because that was my identity, that was my worth. And when you took those things away, what did I have left? And it was a really hard time.
What was that like? What were you going through?
I remember the money I made on Gladiators, I somehow stretched for 6 months. I barely worked out. I was like a total depression. Because I thought, what am I supposed to do here? And I had spent so much time trying to look a certain way and be a certain way that I really spent no time identifying what made me happy. What was I passionate about? What do I do? And I remember I had the conversation with my parents. I had the conversation with a couple mentors of mine from KU. And I just thought, I know I can't stay here. And but had nowhere to go.
But I know this isn't what I need to be doing, but I have no idea where I should
and
be.
And there's a sense in us, we're given the instinct, the intuition to feel what I feel like we have got a compass. At the time, I had no idea what that went. But we make decisions, and we have a feeling that starts from here. When I saw you today, I'm like, ah, Julie. And I literally, I had a lift in my chest. It's a buzz. It's happiness. It's butterflies. It's joy. And it's, to me, a trigger that says, yes.
This is the right direction.
This is the right direction. And then the opposite, of course, is a sink. If to just stay and go back to bartending and not challenge yourself. It's not about bartending. It's about not challenging myself, right? And the sink was what I felt, the thought of, I'm like, can I keep this up?
Kind of taking the easy way, the comfortable way.
Comfort made me sick. I felt so heavy and nauseous. And so I thought, okay, I started some relationships and friendship in LA here. Let me just take a peek. My mentor, my parents were like, listen, home is always going to be here. Go. I really didn't have enough money. I didn't know what I was going to do, but I thought, I'm just going to go and check it out. I've got enough money to last me a few months, and let's just see how it goes. So I remember I drove across the country. I like pinged all these cities, you know, where all my friends
were. Everyone should do that.
It was, oh my God. And by the way, I had like a 98 Ford Explorer. It was rusted. I could see out my rear view. Actually, no, I couldn't because it was loaded to the top. I could see out my side windows and that's it. I didn't even, like, this is before like smartphones.
There's no paper map.
I had a paper map and I had directions written down like 80 west, you know, 35 south. And then what was it? And the K, and then there's another road from Kansas to Denver that's west. And you have to look. You're like, how many miles? And I look at the speedometer, not the speedometer, the mileage tracker. I'm like, what if I miss my turn? And then, oh my God. It was so great.
What a crazy world we lived in.
Oh my God. Oh my God. So I finally got here and I remember crying. I remember thinking, you idiot. What did you just do? I'm renting a house in somewhere in the hills. I was paying way too much for the room. I looked at my finances. I thought, what are you doing? What are you doing 3 months? You're so stupid. I'm shaming myself because now I'm scared. So, of course, the voice of not reason, but of emotion and, you know, being hard on myself came through. And then I remember that my roommate at the time, who I'd never met, says, hey, it's weird. You already have like a piece of mail. I
go, what is that?
Was it like a Bed Bath & Beyond coupon? Like what, you know? And it turned out to be my tax return from the government. And it was like $15,000 or $13,000 from all the taxes I paid on Gladiators 1 year earlier. I remember I started bawling. Because I remember I asked God on the way there. I'm like, you know what? Listen, bro. I always call him bro or something. I don't know. And I was like, hey, bud. I need to know that this is right. And of course, I got there, I bawled, and I got this piece of mail, which that money gave me, instead of 3 months, it doubled the time. And it allowed me to say, okay, there's purpose here. And I met this guy, Mark Carreri. He's the owner of this Pulse Fitness Studio in the Valley. And I just wanted to work. He owned a gym. So I'm going to get to your answer soon. This is a big play-by-play.
She's almost to the gym.
Yeah, I'm almost to a gym. And I thought, oh, this is great.
Yeah.
He'll hire me to run the, like, if you're an employee, you don't have to pay to work out.
Then you can work out
there. I don't
have
any money. Yeah. This is awesome. I want to work the front desk. He goes, I think you should be a trainer. I go, oh, no, 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 no. I don't, no, 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 no. I don't know. I don't want, I'm not a trainer. I'm not, yeah. I don't want to coach. I don't want to, ugh, no way. He goes, no, really. I really think you should do this.
Wow.
And I was like, okay, well, can I work out for free and then I watch you? You know, all yeah. I wanted was a free place yeah. to train. And so sure enough, Mark let me come to his classes for about a month.
Okay.
For free, just observing and shadowing mm-hmm. and working out. And then he gave me a couple classes.
Wow.
And so I started teaching. And the joy I felt from seeing people win, to see yeah. someone's top speed at a 5.0 was like, ah, you're doing it! Which is like, there are other people maybe, it was a 9.0.
Yeah.
And it was a combination of like treadmill and weights and okay. bands and kind of like a nice interval vibe.
Okay.
And I got to play whatever music I wanted and I got to create what I wanted. And my classes that started with like 1, 2, 3 people turned mm-hmm. into 6, 7, 8, turned mm-hmm. into 20, 22, 24.
Yeah.
And over the course of this time, people are asking me to privately train them. I say, oh, no, no, I'll just train you for free.
Yeah.
So I'm training people for free. I'm doing free meal plans. I'm doing classes. And I had done fitness modeling again. And all this movement in this realm, I started to see movement has nothing to do with performance.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it does if you're an athlete and yeah. that's your paid profession, and yep. I understand. But movement makes us better. Movement is my therapy. Movement clears your head. Mm-hmm. It builds your confidence. When I would go and run on a treadmill, which I was terrible at running, to run for 60 seconds straight was hard.
Mm-hmm.
And then to hit a minute 30, and then to hit 2 minutes,
yep.
and then to have a teacher say, all right, we're going to do a 5-minute run. Dread, oh my God, oh my God, and I did it.
Yeah.
And I started to see the way it changed me. I started yeah. to see the way the challenges, being up against that wall, and then just considering what was possible if mm-hmm. I bet on myself.
Mm-hmm.
So now I start to understand this whole different level of psychology,
yep.
behavior, success, joy, growth, all of these things that came just through movement.
Yeah.
Even, and by the way, it includes the kitchen. If I say, okay, Jules, I want you to pack a snack and I want you to eat it every day this week, yeah. 5 days in a row. And you do it, you're mm-hmm. like, oh my God, Jen.
I win. Yeah.
I did it. To see that, like, I said I was going to do X and I completed X, and that makes me feel good, strong, mm-hmm. capable. And it just blew my mind that, I mean, I'm sure there are better trainers out there than me. I'm sure there are smarter trainers that are out there, that their techniques. I mean, people like Kelly Starrett, the way he can open up your body, I was like, I don't know, man. I do like arm circles, you know, but, you know, I continue to be a student.
Yeah.
But I continue to observe the way movement just changed people.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I think that's really what it did it for me, because it changed me so much. Because honestly, when a lot of fitness modeling, I was working out for the waistline.
Right.
Again, it was just, and this is all, by the way, before CrossFit.
Right.
Well before. I just need to look a certain way to be successful, and that's my value. Mm-hmm. But if I didn't look that way, or if I made a food decision that didn't correlate with that,
right.
then I was failing.
And
then I felt worthless.
And yeah.
I mean, I literally got to the point where I was educated so much in training and understood food and understood digestion
mm-hmm.
that I knew that if I, you know, because of that science,
mm-hmm.
there was one time I had like a huge meal, way over 8, extra dessert. And then I started feeling guilty and shame. Mm-hmm. And by the way, this is me, the peak of training.
Yeah.
Clients, people are coming to me for help. And I thought, oh my God, it's been less than 5 minutes. Okay, if I throw up now, it actually hasn't started digesting yet. It's just right, it's right here.
Mm-hmm.
And the thought that I was considering
it, yeah.
throwing up to get rid of the calories, it scared me. And I thought, this goes so much deeper. What am I working towards?
Yeah.
What am I fighting for? I could be a size 0. I wouldn't make this any happier.
Right.
And I think that's what CrossFit really did for me. I have to credit that CrossFit community and the movement and the way you show mm-hmm. up for each other, because I wasn't placing value on completion and, mm-hmm. and moving because it made me feel better.
Mm-hmm.
It was all external, just like I had done in college, just
right.
like I had done in Gladiators.
Right.
And here I am, almost 30 years old, doing it again.
Yeah.
And I couldn't figure out why. I mean, at this point, I was doing work with Men's and Women's Health. I had been doing projects for MSN as a fitness mm-hmm. expert. Biggest Loser twice had come to me
yeah.
asking me to be on the show or to audition for the show
mm-hmm.
and not getting it. And I was like, well, what the what?
Yeah.
What am I doing wrong?
Right.
And I never understood it was because I didn't understand and value who I was. The moment I got me mm-hmm. and put and valued that over anything,
yeah,
it changed my life. The next time, Loser brought me in for Lucky Number 3, and I got the show, mm-hmm. not because I was trying to be who I thought they wanted me to be.
Right,
I
you're said, being yourself.
Me. This yeah. is what I do. One thing I figured out, and this is not ego, this is fact, mm-hmm. and I think it's something that you've harnessed for yourself, and I think people that are successful get it. No one can do what I can do.
Yep.
Nobody. I can't be you.
Yep.
I can't. And you can't be me. And I love that.
Yeah.
We can synergize our efforts like this, our passion. That's why you and I became friends like in an instant.
Yeah.
It's no matter your job, no matter what you're doing, no one can do what you can do.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a power in that. There's a passion in that. And that needs to be for people's first step in every room with their eyes off the ground, knowing that what it is that I'm doing is me. Mm-hmm. And I also realize that our purpose has nothing to do with what we're doing. Like, it's who we are.
Right.
You like doing this podcast. Mm-hmm. I love being on it. This is something we're doing.
Right.
It's not my life's purpose. Who you are mm-hmm. is the purpose. The way you brought me Starbucks today. It's the way you treated the barista. It's the way you interacted with all my friends here that wanted
right.
to meet you.
Right.
That's who you're supposed to. That's your purpose.
Absolutely.
And that's the thing. It's like I feel like because I finally harnessed that and stopped trying to do what I thought someone might want me to do mm-hmm. or say, whether it was for a job, whether it was a guy I liked and wanted to date,
mm-hmm.
whether it was a client that I needed to be honest with, I let that lead the way, and every door is open for me.
What was it that helped you make that switch? You said a little bit CrossFit in the community. Was there a single moment, or did it happen over time? Like, how can you help other people make that same realization?
I think it's a gradual collection of information.
Mm-hmm.
But then I remember there was just a pivotal moment at the end of... what year is it? 2017. I just turned 30. I remember it was about 4 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember just realizing I matter.
Mm-hmm.
I matter. And when I stopped looking at what I think I need to do to see if you want to be my friend, I just started being me. And it sounds so silly, but there was a TED Talk by mm-hmm. Brené Brown.
Oh, I love On Vulnerability. Yep,
watched it. If you guys haven't seen it.
It's the best.
It's got millions of views. Brené Brown and Vulnerability, exactly. Yep. She said the birthplace of human connection is vulnerability,
mm-hmm.
which what that means in layman's terms, if I show you exactly who I am and you like me for that person,
yep.
I actually know you really like me and that you really love me, and that's real.
Mm-hmm.
If I came today and I was like, hey, Jules, oh, you look so great.
Yeah.
I know, even if she likes what I'm doing, I know it's not real, so I don't feel seen, and I don't feel heard, so I don't feel special or important.
Yeah.
And I feel like there was something about that saying, I don't need to please, I just need to show up and be me.
Mm-hmm.
And if who I am can elevate the day of someone else, that's what I'm supposed to do.
So true.
And that's really what it was. And I don't know how... I remember I had a few pivotal conversations mm-hmm. with my family and friends during that mm-hmm. time, and it started to occur that I matter, and mm-hmm. what I feel matters, and I don't matter less. If I met you at Mind Body Green and you didn't ask me to work out, or if you did, you're like, wow, that was a really bad workout, and I don't really like Jen, and gosh, she really talked a lot. And what if you didn't like me, did it make me less valuable?
No.
No, it just means we didn't click, and that's okay.
Right.
Something about being okay with what you put out in the world is important.
Yeah.
But
I think, and I think you can, like people, like you said, people can connect with you more. Like, I felt that as soon as I met you. I knew who you were, but I was like, oh, she's on a TV show. Like, I don't know, what's she going to be like? And then as soon as I met you, you were so genuine and so real. And that, I think, is true. It helps people connect because they realize, okay, this person is really down to earth. They, you know, they're going to show me who they are.
Mm-hmm.
And it forges those connections. So once you kind of realize, okay, I'm important, I'm, you know, I'm going to be vulnerable and be real, you obviously still catch yourself on a regular basis, like going to those old tendencies. So how do you catch yourself? Or how do you
self-awareness. Listen, as much as I'm talking now, there's just as much conversation up here.
Oh, yeah.
I think that the most successful people on the planet are the people that have work ethic, are a pleasure to be around, but also have an accountability for greatness.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I wrote a post-it note on my mirror, and it says, be accountable for your greatness.
Mm-hmm.
No one's going to care more than you do about how you do.
Yeah.
Julie, you didn't have to come here today. You drove up from San Diego in traffic. I mean... I'm making her pick me up food. You know, you came because you are passionate about what you're doing, and regardless of who approves it or not, you care and you live up to that level. Mm-hmm. I also think for people that want to be successful and want to be, how do I say it? I'm kind of tangenting. It's not going to come together, my brain. See, more
it's
conversation
okay. Now you're
here.
Having different conversations
it's,
up there.
It's just, because I thought of something, then I thought of another something yeah. else, and I thought of something, I'm like, ugh. But the reason I got sidetracked is because I was thinking, you know, The Rock won this award recently, and I'm not sure if it was his father that said it, but he says, it's nice to feel important, mm-hmm. but it's more important to be nice. Mm. And it's kind of a thing like no one has to live with your decisions but you.
Right.
And if you want to have a full life, a successful life, a life that feels connection mm-hmm. with people, you have to be responsible for that.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I just think that like I do catch myself. I mean, down to walking in the gym and seeing burpees are running on the board.
Yeah.
That's another moment to practice my success up here. Mm-hmm. I say, okay, shit. I really didn't feel like this today.
Right.
I could just go, I'll just not do it today and I'll go tomorrow. And I think, no, tomorrow is busy. You're ready today. Give the best you can.
Yep.
And I'll even give myself, like, if I'm really feeling beat up with myself or, you know, or worried. I actually have an anxiety now. Mm-hmm. Going to gyms or, like, traveling. Like, I was just in New York and I was at CrossFit Solace and there was this great WOD and I didn't want to do it because I thought, I mean, traveling, I haven't really eaten enough today, and I don't want people to judge me for how I perform. Mm, mm-hmm. And it was written. I don't know if you feel that pressure as well, because
so
you're Julie Fiché. But I feel it because yeah. I'm on TV now, and people know that I'm a trainer, and I don't want to go in the wild and be like, well, she's really, like, kind of out of shape.
Like looking at your time.
Right, yeah. I'm looking at my time, and, yeah. and part of that headspace used to be enough in this right. last 6 months to keep me from doing it. And I thought, no, face it. What advice would you give somebody? Show up and do your best. If you yep. need to slow down, slow down. A lot of times what I'll do, whatever the weight is, mm-hmm. I'll go down 5 pounds or yeah. up 5 pounds. It sounds so funny because now
it gives you a little extra confidence. Yeah.
It's like Julie's, I'm doing different weights.
Yep.
I'm going to move the way I need to move.
Yep.
And it takes me off of the board or people mm-hmm. worrying about it. I think that's what I kind of do. Like the self-awareness, coming back to your question of catching yourself mm-hmm. and redirecting your thought. You've mm-hmm. got to just be responsible and aware of where your default is, which, yep. by the way, goes into my book that I know we're going to talk about. Mm-hmm. But your personality, your behavior defaults are what's going to dictate the way your day goes and what decisions you make.
Yeah.
And the more you can learn about yourself and be aware, like, it changes everything. Like, yeah. I know it sounds so stupid because I'm the one in my brain. Mm-hmm. If there's running on the workout and I'm like, it's a longer run, I don't want to do it, I say, Jen, okay, at the halfway mark, you can walk 10 steps.
Okay.
I give myself a 10-step right. walk. Once I start doing the run, I never take the 10 steps.
Right. You're like, I can do it.
I never.
You build your confidence.
I hit that.
Yes.
And I
exactly.
boom. And I go. And I'm like, you silly rabbit. Why did you teach it to lie to yourself? But it makes me stay.
Yeah.
It sounds so, but stuff like that. That's simple.
Yeah.
I'm
so
checking
true.
Your meter time. Okay.
Okay.
We're good.
I did want to ask you too, before we get to the book, because I do want to talk about that, about Biggest Loser and just about training individuals who are so deconditioned and so overweight. Obviously, you train here and across the gym where generally people are, you know, pretty athletic to start with if they're walking in the door.
Well,
not
even,
always.
Even the weight they have is yeah. not where they're as
right.
Where.
So what is, you know, what drives you to work with that population of people and what do you enjoy so much about it?
Oh, good question. Okay, so first and foremost, there's no difference between my contestants and anybody else.
Yep.
The weight on them, it's like put on 5 weight vests and you might have an idea of what they're feeling. Priority one is keeping them safe and healthy.
Yeah.
And specifically, it sounds so funny, the feet and the knees.
Yeah, with all that extra
that
weight.
That extra
absolutely.
Weight protecting against the pre-stress fracture and stress fracture and making sure they're okay. But ultimately, what I like doing, you can just see it on their face. Mm-hmm. The way... I mean, I like to initially start them moving, doing mm-hmm. a lot of strongman training.
Okay.
Which sounds like, really?
But they're really good at it, right?
Listen, man. Their bodies, believe it or not, have so much muscle on
yeah.
them because you got to carry that load of the
yeah.
extra weight. All I want you to do is push or pull
yep.
or pick up and put down.
Yep.
Those are 4 easy commands. So it keeps it simple. I streamline it all. But it also puts them through a threshold where they feel... that mental crash of, fuck this, I'm over it, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
But they push past, mm-hmm. and then it builds the confidence. Mm-hmm. A lot of it is just this layering effect of showing them what they're capable of, mm-hmm. and how easy it is for them to win. Because mm-hmm. what they see in every situation, whether it's picking a healthy snack, walking into a gym, seeing the workout, yeah. they assume they're going to fail. Why try? Why try to eat healthy? Mm-hmm. Why try to go to a gym? I'm going to fail anyways. Mm-hmm. How can I keep this up?
That's just from the years and years of trying and failing.
But what did I say earlier, right? Mm-hmm. I keep moving to prove to myself I can.
Yeah.
All they've done is to proven that they cannot. Mm-hmm. So that's they're working off evidence. Yeah. They're working off history. Wouldn't you?
Yep.
So it's my job to come in here and redirect the flow, mm-hmm. right? Turn mm-hmm. the pistons around and get them working for themselves. In the beginning, I'm believing for the both of us.
Yeah.
They're thinking, you're nutty, dude. We love you, Jen.
Right.
You're crazy. So in the beginning, they're actually doing workouts to please me mm-hmm. versus themselves. And what's really cool is you start to see this shift in them where they start fighting and meeting me halfway. Mm-hmm. And by the end, they're moving because they know they can, and they're doing it for themselves and for the lives that they want and
That's
for their
amazing.
Families. You know,
yeah.
And what's also cool, you see it in body language. You see it in eye contact. Mm-hmm. You see it in, it sounds so funny, but working out in the ranch. Week one, everyone's a little slow, a little sad. Week yep. two, can we have music? Yeah, you guys can have music.
Maybe then this could be fun.
Then they're fighting over who gets to play what music.
Yeah.
We start dancing. We start like, woo-hoo. Like, you know, that's,
yeah.
that means confidence. That means
yeah.
I'm feeling good. The smiling, the joking, we're rotating who's cooking dinner. I've got confidence. I know what to make.
Yeah.
Right? I'm okay moving. They start to wear it.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's really such a pleasure. That's the thing. Whether you got 100 pounds to lose or 50 pounds or 10 pounds, just start winning.
Yep. Build that confidence.
All you got to do, I mean, I was teaching class today. I thought, your best is always enough. Mm-hmm. It is always enough, but you got to give it. Mm-hmm. You've got to give it. If you keep sandbagging, it's just like that vulnerability with you. If I know I'm going half-assed in a workout, then I know I'm not really going to get better. And it's not going to award you with the feeling and the confidence that you deserve
right.
because you half-assed it.
Right. And you're the only one who knows that.
You're the only one that knows it.
You have to live, uh-huh. live with that.
Uh-huh. But, so I mean, they're just such great. And the hardest thing I will say with Loser, and my client said this to me years ago, and it's stuck. You know, the outside changes a lot quicker mm-hmm. than the inside. Mm-hmm. They're dropping weight left and right, and they look in the mirror, and they see the same person that stepped in the ranch weeks earlier. Mm-hmm. So it's starting to let them accept the change and mm-hmm. conceive that they're worthy of it and mm-hmm. that they're worthy of the attention. I mean, the amount of times when my contestants are having a hard day, I go back to the ranch. I send them pictures.
Yeah,
there's this Vicky from this last season. Mama Vicky, oh my God. I got a picture of her like on a box, like beached whale. Like she is like dying. By the way, 55 years old, did every workout.
Wow.
Every workout. Doing it, right? And then I got her like some weeks later and she's wearing the same shirt, but it's like here. It's
like a dress. It's like
and she's like, I'm like, show me that dress, Vic.
Yeah.
And it was like, and I just said, P.S., don't forget.
Yeah.
And she's like, oh my God.
It's true.
You know, we just, it doesn't stick in mm-hmm. our brains. The mm-hmm. outside goes, but the inside still remembers you a year ago.
Right.
And it really, it takes a lot of support, not only from the coach, but their social circles and their mm-hmm. family circles to help mm-hmm. them believe that they're worthy of the effort and that they can sustain it.
And like you were talking about earlier, so much focusing on what you looked like when you were fitness modeling or for your performance, it's the same thing. It's like you can change what you look like all day, but until you deal with who you are and you start being that person.
Yep.
And really get to know that person.
It's so hard, but it's so simple. Because you know what the problem is? People are afraid what they're going to find.
Yeah.
Let me tell you guys, I have come so far in my life, in my understanding. And I had a conversation on Sunday with a good friend of mine. And I was like crying because I got, man, I got so far to go.
Yeah.
I have so much more. And I'm not afraid of work. And I'm not afraid of looking at reality. Mm-hmm. But I've got more to do.
Oh, yeah.
And it's scary to think, what will I find? What, you know, and how can I come through it? And using history, I've managed to come through everything else in my mm-hmm. life. Whatever's ahead, I know I can do too.
Yeah.
And so that's true. What, by the way, the gym and the resilience and you completing a CrossFit Games, which sounds crazy. You're like, I did this. Mm-hmm. I can do that.
Right.
I could do med school. I can have a hard conversation with someone I care about. You know
right.
what I mean? It prepares you.
It's so true.
Yeah.
It's so true. But we all have so far to go. So speaking of which, let's talk about your book. Yay! So tell us, how did this come about? Where did the idea come from?
Okay. So here I am in Loser. I've got this platform. You know, my social media is growing.
Yep.
I've had this privilege, a humble privilege, to get to be in the lives of people. Mm-hmm. And now people want me to write a book. And I go, what? Do I have to? I don't know. And, you know, I think what I've constantly seen, especially from other fitness professionals, are diet books, books, that this is what you got to do to lose the weight. And I thought, what could I possibly contribute? There's all the books out there. There's all the information. And I actually got in a fight with my literary agent because she's like, you're doing this. We're going to figure this out. Mm-hmm. But I thought, okay, we all know that eat protein.
Right.
We all know drink water. We all know eat your vegetables. Mm-hmm. We all know now that healthy fats are good. We all know this information, and the world has access to everything, but why are we still obese? Why is America getting fatter and fatter by the day? Because it's the application of what we're teaching.
Right.
You know, a mark of a great coach is someone that can teach anybody in the room, that I can communicate in a way that you're going to understand, and then also in a way that you're going to understand, and the way that you're going to understand, whatever that becomes.
Yep.
And I started identifying these motivating cues and characteristics back when I was just doing group classes. Because, you know, everyone's on the treadmills, and I would say something and half the class would respond like, yeah, and go faster. Then I'd have a few people like check their
phone.
What's going on? A couple people slow down.
Yeah.
One person go to the bathroom. And I'm like, I felt like that was pretty motivating. And half y'all just checked out. So I started saying, okay, coaching style.
Right.
But it was also in the way I applied food and nutrition programs.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought, okay, my book, which is Diet Right for Your Personality Type, is essentially a diet book disguised... Oh, sorry, it's a life guide disguised as a diet book. This is a book that basically allows you to, there's a personality assessment that helps you identify, and by the way, celebrate your personality.
Mm-hmm.
I've got 5 core personalities, an organized doer, a rebel, a swinger, an everyday hero, and a never ever.
Okay.
Be proud, okay?
Of who you are
is who you are. This is great.
Yeah.
But by evaluating and understanding who you are and your awareness around it, now you've got some ammunition to do something about it.
Yep.
For the first time, I want people to see that they are an asset, to stop looking at what's on your plate or what's your workout, Julie, what do you do, and start knowing that the information's actually within me and what I need to do. So once you identify your personality, you're given a full program based on that.
Okay.
And so, for instance, if you're an organized doer, which I have a feeling you
are. I have a feeling just from hearing the names, it's probably the one I am.
And by the way, these are names I just made up for like me. I was like a rebel. Okay. Swinger. Like, and my publisher's like, oh, these are great names. I go, oh, no. I'm going to call them all like different beans, like kidney bean, black bean. They're like, that's a terrible idea. No, leave them the names. So the organized doer, for instance, is a plan that when you wake up to when you go to bed, you know what's coming.
Everything written out for
you. A lot of times what I see with your personality is there's effort, you're self-motivated, but oftentimes they go the wrong direction. I had a friend that was running marathons and going and under eating and breaking down and wasn't doing any care. And she was losing weight, but broken. Okay, they often run, no pun, because of the marathons, but in the wrong direction. So to set up a template of what's in each meal, benchmarks to hit, and also a celebration of those. A lot of times personalities of organized doer, they don't really celebrate their success, which is why they end up going hard and burning out. Okay, so that's them. Whereas, for instance, I've got the swinger, which these are the people that your socialites or adventurous. They're like, what's that? I'll try it. Put some on my plate. I don't care.
Next day, something else.
Right. Yeah. They're bounced workout to workout and like, it's not working. Nothing's working.
Right.
Right. They know the instructor's name. They set up coffee for everybody. Yeah. But because they're inconsistent and there's no really long-term follow through, nothing ever works for them. So like, they're just like, well, nothing ever works for me.
Right.
And so what I do is I create a menu style option. So I treat them like these are my kids. So, you know how, I'm not a parent yet, but there's a lot of my friends that have kids are like, you tell your kid, like, you're going to come walk over here and sit down, or I'm going to come get you and you're going to sit down.
Right.
What do you choose?
Yeah.
They're really not choosing, right?
But they feel like they have the choice.
You are going to be here however you want to get here.
Right.
And that's what I do with, like, my menu. So I have essentially breakfast, lunch, dinner. It's a menu options kind of a vibe, and they get to say, oh, I feel like, and frittata today.
Yeah.
And they can, and they, there's an adventure in the menu. But again, whatever those options are hitting what I need.
Right.
Calorically, nutritionally, fats to carbs, everything. It's all set up for them already.
Amazing. Yeah.
But they think they're choosing. They're just choosing in my category.
Right.
Right here.
So then they're going to see more of the results.
Exactly. So that's why it basically hones in on what those defaults are. And there's a whole, there's a conversation I have in the book as well is about behavior change. Mm-hmm. We have to realize that a lot of the reason why people fail is because they try to cold turkey change the behavior
change
who they
everything.
Are.
Yeah.
To, right? How is that going to work?
Right.
There's actually statistics. There's a, I talk about it in my book. It's called the Chan's Theoretical Theory for
yep.
Change.
Oh, yep.
Model for, sorry, Model for Change. I love that you know. This is great. So essentially, I mean, you're the looking at six stages of change.
Yep.
You've got pre-contemplation, contemplation, preparation. By the way, we haven't even started yet, and those are three stages.
Three stages.
A lot of people are at pre-contemplation
yep.
or even preparation. They're not ready.
They're
and
not,
so
whatever you do, they're not going to be
they're
changing.
They're not going to go. I could short-term lose your weight. No problem. We've already talked about that, but yep. that's not my goal. It's long-term health mm-hmm. for what's going to really be working sustainable for mm-hmm. you. So what's... What's great about it, though, it was what the reason it struck me, it's 30 years of research and counting, but somebody that was going to quit smoking,
mm-hmm.
cold turkey, let's do it right now,
yep.
only 3 to 5% of people are successful.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not a surprise that when somebody tries to do a diet cold turkey and doesn't consider any of the behavior,
yep.
only 3 to 5% are successful.
Right.
This is not about smoking. This is not about eating. This is about behavior change.
Mm-hmm.
This is actually, this whole theory has been used a lot for... people that are pre-diabetic,
mm-hmm.
that are, you know, on the verge of type 2 diabetes, and their life and death is imminent
yeah.
Based on what they choose.
They continued on that path,
and
yeah.
And so it's trying to put them through the stages of change in order for them to be
mm-hmm.
Able to not just revert, or I don't want to say revert decisions, but change habits,
yep.
not just for a few weeks to
yep.
get the blood pressure down, but to sustain it.
Right.
And by the way, in the life and the schedule that you have, like you're traveling all this coming month.
Mm-hmm.
What are, based on your personality, setting you up with an organizational opportunity? We have to check your car in 10 minutes.
All right.
Sorry, guys. Right? To be successful in, because that's how
yep.
you operate.
Yeah. It's so true. And it's so interesting when you know about that, because there's people who, once you get so passionate about nutrition and exercise and you just want everyone around you to make those changes, you can start to recognize, okay, maybe my sister, you know, I really want her to start exercising
yeah.
and changing her diet, but she's pre-contemplative. She's not even thinking
yeah.
about it, or she's maybe just thinking about it. And
yeah.
like, whatever you do, as much as you care about her and as much as you try, she's not going to change right now. But it's like all of that effort is not lost
yeah.
because what you're doing is getting her into that next
yes.
stage of change. So it's all about being patient.
Such a good point. I love that you said that. And the other thing too, when you're operating through this, one thing I started to see a lot in my clients as well
mm-hmm.
is, so you're Julie, you're organized doer, and let's say I'm a rebel
mm-hmm.
who are notoriously disorganized,
yep.
chaotic, but somehow effective, you know?
Is that what you really are, rebel?
I'm actually everyday hero.
Everyday hero.
Yeah,
ooh.
Yeah,
and what's
yeah.
that one?
Okay, I'll tell you that next. But a lot of rebels I know are like, I don't know what's wrong with me. I can't keep this schedule. I'm constantly
yeah.
late. Why am I constantly failing? And I'm like, why?
A lot of negative self-talk.
Why,
yeah.
why are you failing just because you're you?
Yeah.
Don't be Julie, be you.
Mm-hmm.
But in that chaos, let me give you some, like, I always joke that my rebels are kind of like bumper bowling.
Okay.
But they're going to party.
Yeah.
They're going to go whatever speed, whatever way, but you're going to stay within the bumpers.
Okay.
And that's
you
what
just
I give
lay
them.
Out some bumpers
Because they need
for
freedom. Because if I restrict them,
yep.
they're going to be like, oh, I'm not going to do this.
Yep. yep.
Not even try, not even start. Or be unsuccessful after a few days.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why, again, you're not doing anything wrong. And you're not. No one's wrong. No one's messed up. No one, if I was only good enough or organized enough,
yeah.
stop it. Be you. It's okay, but let's pay attention to it. And the analogy I love to give is you're driving home from work and boom, pothole.
Mm-hmm.
You know when it hits so hard, you're like, your car
yeah.
hurts. You're like, oh my God.
I got a flat tire
the mirror's
for
on.
Sure.
Am
yeah.
I, you listen for the whap, 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 whap. Like, did
yeah.
I pop it? Let me tell you what, you come home the next day, you remember where that was,
yeah.
and you're like, I remember it was somewhere between the, there it was.
There it is, yeah.
Boom. That's all. It's going to be there. Your defaults are not going to go away.
Yeah.
I have my own tendencies that I still fall into, but I remember, I look for it, boom. I mean, a really great example, when I love going to dinner, I
mm-hmm.
love seeing friends, I love getting a cocktail,
yeah.
I love little appetizers, and I had a long day, I think my last meal was around 12 or 1, mm-hmm. and I go to this dinner, my favorite pizza place. Like, mm-hmm. I already knew I was doing pizza.
Right.
But I think I get there at 7:30, starving. Mm-hmm. I have at least 2 glasses of wine mm-hmm. before the apps even come. And I'm like, oh, mozzarella sticks. We all get the mozzarella sticks. So now I'm making, like, fried choices, even though I knew I was only having pizza.
Yeah.
I go through the basket of mozzarella sticks. Pizza's taking a little longer. I go through bread basket. Yep. Pizza comes. Oh, now it's a party. Oh, I've never tried this one. And I go home feeling shameful because I thought, what happened? I looked down at my plate. All the food had been gone. And I thought, was I awake? Did I enjoy? Was I present?
Yeah.
And then, so instead of being angry at myself or shameful, which is what I would have done 5 years ago, mm-hmm. I thought, okay, hold on. Your last meal was at 12:45, 1 o'clock. Okay, you didn't eat. It was 7 o'clock. You started cocktailing. Okay, then that's why I made those decisions that were bad. So then I think, okay, I cannot go to my rule, mm-hmm. my pothole. Okay, I never go out to a dinner hungry. Mm-hmm. I'll have a serving of like almonds or algae or a piece of fruit, something in my stomach to operate, like bring the sugar levels up and just kind of not be like a crazy hungry person. I'm only allowed one cocktail before dinner.
Okay.
Whether it's drink or wine, whatever it is, I can have one. And if it's out, I'm out. And I can have another one with dinner.
Yep.
But those are my rules. And when I follow my rules, my awareness, I should say, mm-hmm. I never falter.
Yep.
That's it.
Yep. So it's all just figuring out what those rules are going to be for yourself.
Exactly.
That's awesome. So what's the swinger? Or not the swinger, the everyday hero.
Okay, so everyday heroes are people that are last on their list. You often see them in parents. You often see them in service service jobs like nurses, mm-hmm. police officers, trainers, where I would never take on an investment in myself mm-hmm. or any responsibility, even if that means running home to take an hour off to eat lunch or fitting in my hour of workout. I would never take on anything that would be in competition with something I've already promised to someone else.
Okay.
Whether it's a family, a friend, a client, I would sleep less, eat less. If there is one, mm-hmm. we go to a restaurant and there's only one salmon left in the menu, I go, oh, Julie,
you can have it.
You can take it. I'll get the chicken pot pie. Great. I don't care. I'll just take whatever food.
Yeah.
So there is, in a sense, we overwhelm our schedule so much that we lose in the moment, in the when the going gets tough, we hit drive through. What did I have you do today? I did it. I coached all morning. I go, oh my God, Julie, food.
Yeah.
And thank God you were at a place you could get like an egg and like a Starbucks protein pack. But otherwise, I mean, Chipotle is right there.
Yep.
I go to Taco Bell like nothing. I will do it. So that's what starts to happen. And so for them, they really need a little bit of preparation.
Right.
So I call it like their emergency snack stash. Like in their day, that buys in the hour, whether it's almonds, a healthy bar, you know, a meal on the go. Mm-hmm. Because we are never going to put anything, we'll never put ourselves first. Mm-hmm. So when we get to those default moments, we have to make sure that we've scheduled or prepared ourselves to be ready. So even like workouts, I scheduled a workout with a person. I'll cancel on myself any day. Mm-hmm. I would never cancel on you.
Right.
I would never cancel on a trainer.
Right.
I don't care if it's 5 a.m. Mm-hmm. I'd cancel on me like nothing. You? No, I would be there.
Oh, yeah.
And that's what it is.
Yep.
Totally.
Yep. But so true. There's so many people who put everyone else above themselves, which is so important. And like, what an amazing quality to have.
Oh my God, yes.
But then there has to come a certain threshold where you have to make sure you're taking care of yourself, because otherwise you really can't do your best at caring for the people around you.
You're going to burn out.
Yeah.
You're going to be unhappy, and it's a lonely ride. By the end of my seasons when I film, I get too far mm-hmm. gone, and I find myself not eating enough. That's why eating all their meal plans, they're not tons of steps.
Yep.
It's literally like slow cooker, chicken, salsa, hit the go button.
Yep.
Okay. Minute brown rice. Boom. Like, it's got it. Again, they're never going to take on a big thing.
Right.
Not in the chaotic days. And also, it's also finding time for them to mm-hmm. slow down, to have like that daily 10, to, because the tough thing with these personalities, because I know I'm one of them, I know what to do.
Yep.
But I don't do it.
You do it for everyone else.
It's hard on us.
Yeah.
If we could just be as good to ourselves as we're good to others, mm-hmm. we're one of the strongest personalities. But
so
it's a really big if.
So true.
Yeah. Crazy,
oh,
huh?
This is exciting. Well, this will be, I think this will be super fun for people to figure out what their personality type is.
Oh my God, yeah.
Think about, you know, how can they set themselves up for success? So where can people, when does the book come out? Where can people find it?
Oh my God,
it?
So it's on pre-sale now. So okay. Go. You can go to like Amazon.com. They have everything. My book's on there. Or teamjennifer.com. You can see my book in my tour section. I'm going on tour. I'll be like
exciting.
A rock star. but it is on shelves February 7th. And anybody that orders before the 12th, there's like a little bonus like gift
Ooh,
in there for me.
Cool.
Wink, wink.
It's worth it.
Yeah, it's worth it. So there you go. But awesome. Yeah, that's probably the easiest way.
Very exciting.
Yeah.
Very exciting. Well, I want to wrap up with three questions I ask everyone on the podcast.
Oh, God. Okay.
Woo. So the first one is three things you do on a regular basis that have the biggest positive impact on your health.
Three
Top
things.
Top three.
Okay. Sounds crazy. The moment I wake up in the morning,
yep.
Tall glass of water.
Yes.
Do not go
That's
a day
great.
Without it. I slug it down.
And just plain water? Do you do like lemon or salt
if
or
I'm
anything
feeling,
crazy?
I might do lemon sometimes.
Okay.
Lemon, that's a great like kind of cleansing vibe.
Yep.
I know the power of lemon, but I just care about getting the water
or
anything. I literally have it in my bathroom, kitchen, yep. right there, ready to go. It's set up. Boom. Chug. It gets me digestively going. Everything's good. I drink more water during
yep.
the day. When I don't do it, like today,
yep.
I do it.
Get that water before you start
yeah,
your coffee, definitely.
I hug as many people as I can a day. I do.
That's
I'm
great.
A physical touch person.
Yep.
It changes me. It changes them. It keeps me like that beach ball in a concert crowd. It just keeps me popping and
yep.
popping. Like I just feel great knowing I'm connecting with people
yep.
and spending time and knowing really letting people know that I see them and
mm-hmm.
I hear them. And it also makes me feel really seen and heard as well.
Yeah.
And
Miss Everyday Hero.
Huh?
Miss Everyday
right,
Hero.
Oh, right? Is it so me? And then I got to tell you one thing that I take algae every single day.
Mm.
I mean, because I was going to say workout.
Yeah.
I love working out. We all
sure.
know why working
yeah.
out's good. I take this stuff. It's from watershed.net.
Okay.
It is chlorella spirulina. It's 1,000 tablets. Cost you $35.
Mm-hmm.
It is a plant-based protein. One change I made in my diet starting in like 2009, I was
mm-hmm.
going to Rwanda and I was like, I need to get another source of food because I don't know what we're running into here because
yeah.
I was volunteering and we're in the middle of nowhere. And it's a plant-based protein that's it's a toxifier. It purifies your blood.
Mm-hmm.
It's a colon cleanser. It digests further in your system than any other food on the planet. It is truly a superfood.
Mm-hmm.
That has done more for me in keeping me sustained in my days. It's
mm-hmm.
a great, I just throw the tablets in my hand. I feel like
yep.
it's a way to get more greens in.
Okay.
My skin has never been closer to my muscle. Like
wow.
I used to have like this layer of kind of fat. It's changed my life. I will not go a day without it.
Wow. It's
yeah.
a good one. I haven't heard that before.
Oh, really? It's even
mm-hmm.
now, like if I'm running around and I know I'm not going to be home for like an hour, handful of algae, boom.
Wow.
Now my metabolism's running. It's basically just a really super salad
mm-hmm.
and a handful.
And a little
chill. Check it with water. And then
All
they
right.
do it in powder form too, but
yep.
I'm not going to drink
right,
algae.
That down.
No. Ugh. Yeah, you don't want to chew it. Like it's not like, ooh,
right.
this is delicious. It's not like chocolate covered.
Right.
It's just greens and it but changed everything for me.
Awesome.
There you go.
What about one thing that you think would have a big impact but you're not very good at working it in?
Reading.
Oh.
I find that a lot of my success in my life has become because I've allowed myself to be the student as well as the teacher.
Yep.
Allowing yourself to learn, as you obviously really know right now, finishing up with med stuff. But reading is such a wonderful way, whether it's blogs or Wall Street Journal articles or even books and
mm-hmm.
novels, whether they're fiction or nonfiction.
Right. Imagine that, reading a book.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
To take in that information, I always feel better. I feel like I'm a better communicator. I learn words.
Mm-hmm.
I have things to bring up to people and, you
yep.
know, it connects me to people. And I just simply don't. I do like once a week, tops.
Mm-hmm. Hey, that's better than none.
Oh,
but
that's true.
Yeah.
Thank you. I'm trying.
Is there a recent favorite thing that you've read or book or article or... Do you have a go-to?
Diet Right for Your Personality
yeah.
Type. My book.
I'm sure you've read that a lot of times recently.
What's it called? I was actually just given a gift, The Traveler's Gift.
Okay.
And I'm about to start reading it. But my friend Andrew at Reebok, Andrew Connors, one of my best friends,
very
he goes,
good.
This is, oh, you know Andrew.
Yeah, yeah.
He's like, this is going to,
This is a good one.
This should be good. So that's
my. Look into that.
Yeah.
Very good. All right. Last question is, what does a healthy life look like to you?
Oh, gosh. It's simpler than it sounds. Like, you would think it's all these things. Try to move once a day. It's really a simplicity. It's even it's 20 minutes. You move once a day. Move once, hug three times, and laughing unlimited.
Yeah.
Right? I feel like that's what it is, to feel productive and to move towards something, all that stuff. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But move once, hug three times, laugh unlimited. That's what I'll
say. I love that, because it's about using your body. It's about connecting with people, having people in your life who care about
that's
who
all
who
we're
we
here
care
for.
About.
It's for
and
each
having
other.
A good time. Yeah.
This is a big world, and there are days I get to the end of it and I'm lonely, and I think, okay, you're not alone, but it's easy to feel that way. So those are, it's truly that. Because the thing, the movement thing takes care of my water and my food. Because listen, like, knowing I'm going to work out, I'm not going to Chipotle before the workout.
Right.
So I eat better. I drink more water because of it. The hugging is connection and community. And the laughter, it's like, you got to know that if you're not laughing, if you got, what is that? I was going to swear. What's it like?
Oh.
That permanent... swear word, you know, permanent mad face. Get it off your face, man. Don't honk at people.
Right.
Start laughing.
Right.
Share the love. That's
so
it.
True.
People are everything.
So true. I love it. That's beautiful. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for your
thank
time.
You, babe.
And thanks for having me.
Oh my God, of course.
Let's go work out.
Okay.
Thank you guys so much for tuning into this episode. I had a ton of fun with Jen, and it was so great to hear how her own personal experiences and struggles help her to connect with those she trains now. After all, we're all on this journey toward health together, so it's great to see what she's doing. Make sure you check out her new book, Diet Right for Your Body Type, which is out this week. To make sure you never miss an episode and to receive exclusive content from me, head to my website, juliefouche.com, where you can subscribe to my email list. Also, don't forget to share your stories. If you or someone you know has used lifestyle to overcome a serious health challenge, please email me at info@juliefouche.com. I'll choose some of these inspiring stories to share here on the podcast in future episodes. If you like what you hear, don't forget to subscribe and consider giving the podcast a 5-star rating on iTunes. Also, don't forget you can train with me by visiting beyondthewhiteboard.com/juliefouche. I always love hearing your feedback, so please leave comments under this post on my website, juliefouche.com, and share your thoughts on social media with the hashtag JFHealth. Thank you again so much for listening, and I'll catch you next time on Pursuing Health.